foot.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So this is joint work with Sebastian, Faust, and Francois-Xavier Standaert. And it's also about hardware Trojans, and it's more like on the theoretical side. So we show a generic framework for modeling hardware Trojans and a generic countermeasure against hardware Trojan attacks. Let me start with explaining the title. So we call it Private Circuits 3, and it relates to previous work by other people on private circuits. So it started in 2003 by a paper by Ishai Sahai and Wagner, where when they were considering side channel attacks on the devices. So they were just assuming device is working correctly, but it's leaking something. So that was like Private Circuits 1 paper. Then there came Private Circuits 2 paper, where they extended the model, so they were assuming that the adversary can also tamper with the device. And well, our paper is the third one in this line, so it's a paper where we will assume that even the manufacturing process of the circuit may be faulty. Okay, so what is the, and of course all these techniques can be combined in reality. If you want to use them, then you can combine them. Okay, so what is the problem that we are attacking? And this was basically explained on the previous talks. I'll go through it quickly. So the problem that we are addressing is the outsourced hardware manufacturing. So the basic problem is that typically nowadays when people design hardware, design integrated circuits, they start with some design process somewhere, say here in Austria, and then they send the description of the circuit that they designed to some factory in some other countries, mostly in China, and then they get back the device. Okay, so this is how it works, how circuit manufacturing works nowadays. And the problem that was discovered some years ago is that, well, we don't need there is no reason really to trust that the circuits were manufactured correctly. So what can happen is that we designed our circuit, we send it to the manufacturer, and the manufacturer sends us a device that differs from what we ordered, and it differs in the sense that it has a hardware Trojan inside. Okay? So hardware Trojans were explained on the previous talk. What can hardware Trojan do? Typically, hardware Trojan, what the hardware Trojan will do, it will for a while behave normally, so the device with the hardware Trojan will behave completely as it's supposed to behave, and then it will activate and cause some damage. Okay? So that's what makes this hardware Trojans such a difficult problem, that usually for a while a device with a hardware Trojan behaves correctly. What can trigger a hardware Trojan? Here we have the following classification. So we can have some physical conditions, like there can be some kind of like GPS antenna embedded in the device, so the device would start to malfunction in a certain position, or some clock or some temperature information or things like this. These are physical conditions. Well, there can be also user's input. So well, the Trojan can simply receive some instructions, start your attack, so start behaving maliciously from the outside, so via some digital channel, or we can have some state inside, so we can count the number of executions. So for example, after 1,000 of executions, the device stops working, and it's sometimes called a time bomb in practical community. So what we are interested in this talk are these two latter types of attacks, so the digital ones. Okay, so we're interested in digitally triggered Trojans, not in physically triggered Trojans. Okay? So what can Trojan do when Trojan activates? It can simply make the device stop working, so it can make the device simply halt, or it can cause some damage by malfunctioning, so the device can produce wrong outputs on some inputs, or the device can simply leak its secret state. So for example, it can leak its secret key to the adversary in plain text. It can just leak it in the open, or it can use some kind of secret channels, like subliminal channels, so the owner will not even be aware that something leaked. Okay? So it's a serious problem, and a natural question is what kind of countermeasures we can have against this. So a natural countermeasure is a direct inspection. Okay, so once you get your chip back from your from the factory, you just analyze if everything is okay. This is of course problematic. It's often destructive, and it takes a lot of money, and it's hard to perform in real life. There are other methods, like on the previous talk, we had an example. Like you can use some side channel information, so you can use the side channel leakage in a positive way. But it obviously also has some limitations. You also need to be able to measure the side channels, and doesn't always work. So. From the practical point of view, like when you think about what's the easiest thing you can do, we can do testing, right? So, and it was also mentioned on the previous talk. So you can just test the input-output behavior of the device, okay? So you get your device from your manufacturer, and you start testing, and you compare if what you got is what you are supposed to get, okay? So you just compare it with your original design. And what is the obvious problem that was also mentioned on the previous talk? Well, we can say it simply like this, that security is hard to assess via random testing. Okay? Why? Because we are always, it's a general common wisdom about cryptography and security, that cybersecurity is hard because it's hard to assess by testing. That's why we need proofs in cryptography. So what can happen is, for example, that there is a specific input that they call a cheat code or a secret password that would make the device malfunction. Okay, so the device will behave normally until it gets some secret password, and the secret password is long enough that it's hard to guess. Then, of course, we'll not detect this secret password, this cheat code, by a random testing. The probability is exponentially small that we'll detect it. Another problem is that if you test t times the device, and the device has a counter inside, then what can happen is that the device stops working after t plus one times, right? So you test it for t times, it works okay, but does it mean that it will still work okay after one more time, right? So these are problems with testing, and the question is what to do. Well, a natural problem is that comes to mind is to logically decompose this device into sub-devices. Okay? So instead of having one device, we'll have several devices, manufacture each of them separately. Okay? And this can be done either in one factory or in several different factories that do not conspire against you jointly. Then test of each of these devices separately and compose these sub-devices into one device at home. Okay? So a natural thing would be decomposing them in different devices, test of them separately, and somehow combine it back at home. Okay? And this is known in already before this method is called split state manufacturing. So you do it like this, and of course this is a very abstract description. I mean, it's then of course this combining composing process can it requires work, right? But abstractly it can be described like this. And our contribution is to provide a formal framework for reasoning about hardware Trojan attacks, and we produce. We provide generic countermeasure that is, in some sense, the generalization of this split state manufacturing. Okay. And we prove its security. Okay, so this is what I'm going to talk about now. So our choice for the model is that we have a strong model where all manufacturing can happen at one factory. Okay, so you have one factory, you send to it a description of device. Now we send it like number of descriptions because maybe you ask different types of devices. Then you get back a lot of little devices, like we call them sub-devices, and they may have different specifications, right? So maybe this one implements these two implement this specification. And then you test each sub-device, okay? So you said test the first one, you test the second one, and so on. And then you somehow compose these things into one, okay? If the testing was okay, right? So the assumption that we have is First, we assume that devices are deterministic and can be described as Boolean circuits, or as any kind of circuits. So why do we assume that they are deterministic? So we will assume that this can be done without big loss of generality because we can always generate randomness pseudo-randomly. Then we will assume that there is an upper bound n on the number of times device is used in real life. Okay, so we know that this device will not be used more than like 1 million times in real life. And we assume that the adversary, the device that was produced by the adversary, can also be represented as a circuit, right? So this is kind of like may look like a trivial assumption, but it's in fact important because by saying this, we basically mean that we consider only digitally triggered trojans. Okay, so we will not consider trojans that can be triggered by some physical conditions. That's why we assume that everything that happens is digital, right? So we can model even the malicious devices can be modeled as circuits. Okay, so what is our framework more formally? So what do we need? We need a transformation, we call it TR, that transforms the circuit into a number of subcircuits. Okay, so here we have some circuit that we really want, this is a circuit gamma, and we want some kind of transformation to transform it into several subcircuits. Okay? Then this subcircuit will be produced by some adversary, by the factory, and we need a master circuit to compose them back into the device that we want. Okay, so master circuit is a method for composing the sub-devices back into one, so that we get functionally the same as we wanted. Okay. And we will assume that this master circuit is produced by a trusted party. And of course, we have to be careful not to trivialize our problem, because if we assume that something is produced by a trusted party, then the natural question is why not to produce everything at trusted party. So what we also need is a testing algorithm for each subcircuit. So we need a way that, there's a tester. So when he gets back the devices, then he can play with each of these devices that he got and say yes or no, like if the tests went okay or not. Okay. So at the end, and we will say that this tester T is T bounded if he gets tested each sub-device at most T times. Okay, so at the end we have the following definition. So we have this triple TR, this is the transformation M and T. So TR is the circuit transformation, M is the master circuit, and T is the tester. And we say it's TN epsilon robust, where T is the number of times we tested, N is the number of uses of the circuit in real life. And if for every malicious manufacturer, the probability that this thing happens here is at most epsilon, where this thing is that T outputs okay, so the tests were passed, and we got a problem in real life. Okay, so this is the best situation for us. That this is when the adversary succeeds. If we didn't detect it during testing, but he caused our device to malfunction. Okay. We need one more assumption. So the basic question is, how simple can this master circuit be? Okay, so can we have like really simple master circuits? Remind you, master circuit is the way to combine circuits that you got from the manufacturer into one circuit. So this is the circuit that we want to have, and like ideally what we would like to have is that we basically connect wires. Okay? So we connect wires, we connect the input to some sub-device here, then we connect this output of this sub-device to the next sub-device and so on. Okay, this is what we would like to have ideally, and the question is if you can have it. And a simple observation is that that's not really possible, because if an input to the device is passed directly to some sub-device, then the adversary can trigger a Trojan by some secret password or secret cheat code. So the device would behave normally until it gets a cheat. So one to say this sub-device will behave normally until it gets some cheat code, okay, in which case it stops. Okay? But before stopping, it forwards it to the other device. Okay, so if you have a situation like this, and this guy gets a cheat code pi, then what he would do, he would send the spy further to the next devices and stop himself. Okay? And each of the next devices will do the same, and at the end everything will stop. Okay? So if we so what was the real problem here? The real problem was that this first device here was directly connected to the input. Okay? So the adversary could trigger the bad behavior just by passing this input to this first device, and then it would propagate. So the moral is that the master circuit cannot be too simple. It needs to perform some non-trivial operations. And in particular, it cannot be directly connected. It cannot directly connect the input to the input of the one of the sub-devices. Okay. In other words, what we need is we need that the input needs to be processed by some gates before it goes to the sub-circuits. Okay. And also, it's easy to see that the input cannot be the input that goes to one of the sub-circuits cannot be a deterministic function of the input, because we would again have the same problem. Okay. So basically what happens is that we need something like this, that the input is somehow, so we do some computation on the input, and then we pass it to the, to at least two devices. Okay. So what is our construction? Well, so we start with this question, like how to design the master circuit. And of course, we want to have it as simple as possible. So what can be the simplest operation that we have in real life? Well, probably XOR is one of the simplest ones. So what we do is we simply assume that the secret secret input, or the input of the device, is secret shared into by two out of two XOR secret sharing. So we'll have like this that, well, taking out, it would like look like this. So if you have input x1 to x4, then you would take a random ri, add it, and then take this xi and add it here. So to like here we have x1 plus r1, here we have r1, and so on, right? Here would have x2 plus r2, here we have r2, and so on up to x4 plus r4 and r4. Okay? So you secret share the input. Okay? So we have the following situation. The input is shared by this to these two devices, okay, by secret sharing. Okay. So this is the, how the master circuit starts operating. And then an obvious question is, okay, what next? Okay, so what to do with these shares? Okay, how to compute the information further? And of course, it's also easy to see that if you look at the circuit further, there cannot be really a situation where a separate individual device gets some non-trivial information about the input. Okay? Why? Because you would have, again, this triggering attack. Okay? So the triggering attack, input triggering attack, works if some part of the circuit, some sub-circuit knows what was the input to the whole circuit. Okay? So we need to do computation in such a way that no sub-circuit gets any information about the input. Okay? And what is a natural idea here? Just use two-party secure computation protocols. Okay. So this is a standard technique from cryptography. I'm not going to define it here, but basically this technique allows us to compute any function we want in such a way that none of us learns the input. Okay. So, so we have some sharing, okay? So we share the input, and then we exchange some information via two-party protocol, and at the end, the output is reconstructed also by the master circuit and produced as output. Okay. So what is the problem with this solution? The problem is that the two-party protocols that we know, they are all based on computational assumptions, and they're not really efficient. Okay? I mean, there's a lot of progress with making them more efficient, but they are still not as efficient as we would like them to be. So what is so what to do? What turns out is that there exist much more efficient protocols, but these are protocols that are information theoretically secure, and they are multi-party computation protocols. Okay, so they need more than two parties. Okay, and they are much simpler computationally because it's like a very simple arithmetic polynomial. So you can just do them basically using XOR. And what is the classical result in this area? So the classical result is the most classical result is that if n is the number of parts, the parties. Okay, and k is the number of function malfunctioning parties that we can tolerate, then if cheating is only passive, then we can tolerate k less than n, than half of n cheaters, and if it's active, we need n over 3. Okay? Okay, so let's look at the this MPC multi-party protocols and decide which to use. And well, the first question is if we have to choose passive security or active security. And well, at the first sight, one could think that active is the best choice, because we are here in kind of like an active scenario, right? So the active security means that the device may simply differ from the behavior of the device may differ from the protocol, which would seem like we are here. Like this is our situation, that our devices malfunction in an active way. What turns out that in this particular setting, there is not really much difference between passive and active. The reason is that, well, suppose that one device becomes malicious for some reason, okay? Then it's enough that this for this device to corrupt everybody. Okay, so if this device gets malicious, then this device can simply send a cheat code to everybody, and this cheat code will be propagated over the device. Okay, so once one person gets corrupt, it's over. Okay, so basically, the thing is that we don't gain anything by assuming active security, and that's why we just will use a passively secure protocol. So we'll have n equal to 3 and k equal to 1. That's the simplest non-trivial case that we can have, and well, that's the situation. The protocol works like this: that so we share the input, right, using this XOR secret sharing. And we had the third party. The third party who takes no input just produces randomness. This is how this one out of three secure MPC protocol can work. So we can have one party that takes no input just produces correlated randomness for these two. And then we have a reconstruction procedure, and that's it. Okay. So we just have a simple MPC protocol where these things are really simple here. Okay? And then the question is how to test, okay? So once we have this protocol, how to test if the device behaves correctly? Like, as I told you, every circuit transformation scheme has to come with a tester. So what we do is here we have a device that we want to test. So what we do is we have a tester that would simply emulate the honest execution of the circuit on arbitrary input. The input here doesn't matter. And then talk to this tested device and simply forward. So whenever this guy here wants to send something to this device, to a device here, you would just forward it to the tested device. Okay? So you would just kind of use this kind of, instead of plugging, so you kind of virtually plug in this device here, okay, and test if it worked correctly and compare with the original design. Okay? So to compare if you got what you should. And well, why does it work with the, why it works with the arbitrary input? That's precisely because it's an MPC protocol. Okay, so what this device gets doesn't depend on the input of the whole device. Okay, this is a property of MPC that no individual device learns the input. Okay. Another observation is that the number of tests that we have has to be random, as otherwise, and this is what I already said, basically, you have this problem that if the adversary knows how many times he will be testing, then he can just make the device stop working just after you stop testing, right? So the solution is that you have to randomize the number of tests. Okay, so this is one practical observation, that you have to randomize the number of times you will be testing so that no adversary can predict it. And we show that the probability that device passes a test and but fails during the execution is at most n over t. So if this number of times we test is chosen from between 1 and 2 t, so this is the number of times that the device will be run in the real life, and this number of tests. And well, of course, it works assuming that we can test more times than the device will be really used in real life. Okay, so it doesn't work for all devices. It doesn't work for devices that will be really used like a very large number of times. But whenever you have a device that we can somehow realistically bound the number of times it will be used in real life, and we can, if we can test more times in our lab, then it will work. Okay. The natural question is how to amplify security, because this is like a polynomial thing, right? So we'll never get like a negligible error here. So how to amplify security? So a simple solution is to take majority, okay? So we do the same things L times. We just repeat the same thing L times, and we take the majority of outputs. Okay? So even if one of these things fails, most likely it will not influence the output, because it will be kind of overwhelmed by the correct output from others. Okay? Our main result at the end is we construct a TN epsilon Trojan Rabas scheme, where T was the number of times we test, N was the number of times we use it in real life, where epsilon is this, okay, N over T to lambda over 2, plus some negligible error if we generate randomness pseudo-randomly, okay, because then we get computational security since this pseudo-random generators are computationally secure. Okay, that's it. Thank you.